It fell about the Martinmas time, when the green leaves they were falling. Then Sir John Grime o' the North Country fell in love with Bobby Allen. He sent his man through a' the town to the place where she was dwelling.
From Volke to folk to roots, how recording technology influenced folk music in North America. Humans have probably been singing since they developed language. In the late 18th century, European intellectuals began looking at rural populations for a more authentic expression of their historical cultural values than the current elite representations. The leader of this movement was a German named Johann Gottfried Herder, who contrasted Kultur des Volkes, culture of the people, against Kultur der Gelten, learned culture. Herder believed that folk forms could cleanse the artificiality that was poisoning modern life. These ideas captured the minds of a generation of intellectuals, and a rush to identify and understand folk cultures began. Herder himself published a collection of folk songs in 1778, in which he would use the new term Volkslieder, folk song. In England, the popularity of folk ballads was well enshrined at this time, with at least three notable collections, including Thomas Percy's Relics of English Poetry of 1765. While Percy depicted these ballads as works of high culture, the poets and intellectuals of the era took them as poetry from the masses and proof of the creative powers of untrained folk. In Britain and in continental Europe, people came to believe that for a country to have a distinct cultural voice, it must know its own folk culture. This was the era of the famous Brothers Grimm, and they would publish their first collection of folk tales in 1812. Foreshadowing one of folklore's enduring debates, questions of authenticity regularly arose. Herder himself distinguished between the Tubolk, usually rural peasants, and what he called rabble in the streets, who never sing or rhyme, but scream and mutilate. Even the songs and stories found among authentic folk were carefully screened and sometimes edited to ensure the original cultural aspects that the collectors were seeking were indeed present. Percy admitted to corrections and additions of the ballads in antiques, and this controversial practice continued among folklore collectors more or less until the middle of the 19th century. Francis James Child was a Shakespearean scholar and Harvard professor whose interest in ballads took the ideals of people like Herder, Percy, and the Brothers Grimm and applied a level of scholarship and scientific rigor that laid the foundation for the American folk song movement. He was a literary folklorist for whom the ballad was a narrative song or a short tale in lyric verse, and always saw the poetry as separate from the melody. He also believed that the oral art of ballad creation and transmission was already dead at the hands of the printing press, which had arrived in England in 1475. Child only accepted ballads as true folk creations if they were recorded in manuscripts and transcribed before the date the printing press came to England. In his 1882 masterwork, The English and Scottish Popular Ballads, he printed all the variants he found, 1,300 versions of the 305 different ballads. This standard of scholarship and collecting became the one to which all folk songs were judged. Therefore, it was natural when people began to look for the songs that Americans sang, they looked for ballads, and child ballads in particular. The late 19th century was also the dawn of recorded audio in the United States. Thomas Edison constructed the first functional phonograph in 1877, mechanically recording sound straight from the air. The cylinders of the original recordings produced copies of lower sound quality, and the copying process rendered master cylinders unusable after 25 copies. In 1887, Emil Berliner received a patent for the flat disc gramophone, and making copies now became more economical. Berliner even released a few early traditional commercial recordings in the 1890s that included Dixie, Virginia Camp Meeting, and A Day in the Country School. He would co-found the Victor Talking Machine Company in 1901. By 1905, family parlor time often included listening to a short recorded music performance on the talking machine. In his 2004 book Capturing Sound, Mark Katz calls the consequences of the ability to record music phonographic effects. At this point in time, the phonographic effects of most concern were temporality and receptivity. Temporality refers to the storage limits of the recording medium. 3 minutes for early phonograph tracks, meant that shorter performances now became the preferred subject of early recordings. Receptivity is the consequence of the recording device not being able to sense sound the same way as the human ear. The earliest recordings were made with a stylus at the end of a huge audio horn that performers played into. In order not to overwhelm the stylus, or in some cases because the stylus was not sensitive enough, performers had to change their physical position with respect to the cone to get acceptable recordings. Some instruments did not record well, and substitutions like tubas for upright basses and wood blocks for skin drums were necessary. Katz mentioned other phonographic effects of recorded music, and their effects on folk music and its transmission will be discussed later. Briefly, they are tangibility, portability, invisibility, and repeatability. Recorded music was now more than just sound or performance art. It was a tangible physical object that could be purchased and stored for use at any time in the future. It allowed selective, solitary listening, where music had normally been consumed at a live performance in community. It also allowed listeners to hear music that they did not have physical access to for geographic or economic reasons. Playback of recorded audio out of context also removed a lot of the visual aspects of music performance, rendering it now invisible. And finally, like print, audio recording made previously short-lived sounds almost eternal. This repeatability meant that entire performances could be listened to word for word and note for note almost an unlimited number of times. Concurrent with the dawn of recording at the turn of the 20th century, American folklore interest became focused on the Appalachian Mountains of the eastern United States. The earliest published folk songs in the U.S. were a collection from North Carolina in the Journal of American Folklore in 1893. Early collectors were ballad-focused and carefully noted the number of any child ballads they found. Songs were rarely contextualized, nor was much commentary on the singer provided. In 1916, Cecil Sharp arrived from Great Britain and began 12 months of collecting songs over three expeditions from 1916 to 1918. Sharp was a collector in the child tradition and collected 1,600 versions of 500 songs from 281 singers, almost all of it British-derived material. He actually refused spirituals and other forms from his contributors. While in the mountain communities, he was struck by the vibrancy of the folk tradition, which he described as oral, remarking that he did not have to collect solely from older members of the community, as everyone seemed to have songs to contribute. While Sharp had followed Child's lead in documenting every variant of ballad he heard, with notes on the singer, his book, English Folk Songs from the Southern Appalachians, strayed from previous Child disciples in that it presented songs with the music so that they could be sung. He believed this is of great importance for British national education so that future musicians could be well-versed in the nation's musical vernacular. He and other British folk revivalists also hoped that folk culture like his collected songs could rescue society from what they considered as the present era's vulgarity and restore the previous wholesome simplicity. At this point in the late 1910s, American folk music was still generally considered old songs, usually ballads from Great Britain, sung by isolated white mountain people. African-American music had enjoyed some popularity as well, but the myth of true American folk combined with racial prejudice prevented African-American song from being acknowledged as American folk music. In the 1870s, in the wake of the Civil War, almost 50 years before Cecil Sharp landed on American shores, Northerners had become interested in spirituals sung by African-Americans themselves, as opposed to the prior blackface Caucasians of the earlier minstrel shows representing African-American culture. Unfortunately, this interest in the music did not seem to extend to the perception of the performers themselves. By 1909, one of the most famous groups, the Fisk Singers, dressed conservatively, performed focused arrangements, and their songbook had gone through five printings, but a Cincinnati newspaper still referred to them as a band of Negro minstrels. At the time, only Howard Odom was studying and recording black vernacular music, but this was only for documentary convenience and from a sociological perspective. He was not really interested in preserving the music or sympathetic to the position of African Americans in society. Although the technology to record and playback music was available to collectors as early as 1904, many of them, like Sharp, didn't see the value in recording the singer's performances as the preservation of the ballad, the text, was seen as primary. Some field collectors like John Lomax and his son Alan in the U.S. and Marius Barbeau in Canada would eventually amass large collections of a wide variety of songs such as blues, gospel, prisoner songs, cowboy ballads, sea shanties, fishing and other work songs, but when these were recorded it was usually with the goal of preservation and or transcription of better texts. Record companies had not begun to record much American folk material, instead choosing to target recent immigrants in urban settings. This meant recording traditional material and selling records back to the communities that had produced the music, since record executives couldn't see any other market for them. Columbia's 1913 catalog had 2 pages of folk songs and traditional melodies, but only 6 of the 48 selections were American in origin. In total, there were more than 200,000 recordings of ethnic music recorded in the U.S. between 1893 and 1942 on Victor, U.S., Columbia, and other small and large labels. In the case of some Irish fiddlers, the early recordings of Michael Coleman and James Morrison demonstrated the power of the portability and repeatability of the new medium of records. These made-in-the-USA recordings would become major influences on the standard repertoire of Irish musicians, one that present-day musicians continue to draw on. The first commercial AM radio broadcast originated in Pittsburgh in 1921, and with the expansion of the radio network, Southern folk music styles began to gain popularity, and the record companies took notice of a new demand. Artists and repertoire, A&R men, like Ralph Peer from OK Records, headed out in search of music that would sell. In this way, corporate decisions began to influence rural culture based on what was selected for recording and what was not. This provided another example of how the repeatability of recorded music could affect the repertoire and style choices of folk musicians. Unlike the folklorists, Peer and other record company representatives were not beholden to a specific type of traditional song like ballads, and they knew that music did not have to be 300 years old to be old-timey. They were more likely to focus on the lively and fluid repertoire played at modern public gatherings. In this way, artists who were comfortable playing traditional music in styles that appeared to hillbilly audiences, but who could also contribute original material in that style, came to be in demand. Recordings of the country and folk styles, a category now dubbed hillbilly by Peer at this time, were a mix of field and studio. At first, instrumentals were considered a safer sell, but in the later 20s, vocal songs became more popular. Remote recordings, like Peer's famous sessions with Fiddlin' John Carson in 1923 and the Carter family and Jimmy Rogers in 1927, followed this timeline. These southern sessions shared space in the record catalogs with the City Billy studio recordings using professional musicians and singers like Vernon Dalhart, covering traditional material and in some cases original songs. While the recording industry was influencing hillbilly recording artists, the sounds from the South were beginning to capture the imaginations of urbanites as well. According to the musicologist Charles Seeger, radio and recording technology enabled an exchange of cultural material like never before. Almost overnight, the constant, slow, ages-old interchange of materials between city and country, between folk, popular, and fine arts of music, was vastly speeded up. Country singers were recorded by phonograph and folklorists were drawn into radio programs. City people, always on the lookout for new things and for broader cultural life, heard the records and broadcasts, but in the process, the songs themselves, even the idiom in which they were molded, began to change. Thus, the hillbilly and citybilly, though using the same musical materials, crossed paths while going exactly opposite directions. Popular records produced in this era were now categorized in 3 ways: hillbilly, white southern folk, race, African American music, and ethnic, other cultural traditions, each with their own catalog numbers and marketing. Sometimes these categories and artists were recorded by the same A&R men in the same studios on the same trip. Indeed, it was Ralph Peer who created OK's Race record series in 1921 that was imitated by all the other big players, and by 1927, the record industry was issuing 500-plus race records per year, including blues, string bands, and jazz singers. When many of these record companies went out of business during the Depression, many of the bluesmen, like Blind Willie Johnson, just stopped recording. The phonographic effect of tangibility, portability, and repeatability afforded by their records allowed enthusiasts in the 60s to dig through bins and collections to rediscover some of these performers during the folk revival. This would lead to some of the surviving artists performing once more on the folk festival circuit. Hillbilly recording artists from the South were also influenced by the blues to the point where white artists were sometimes mistakenly end up on race records. Jimmy Rogers' Blue Yodel No. 1 sold over 1 million copies, and artists like the Monroe Brothers incorporated the blues into their proto-bluegrass sound. This level of cross-pollination might seem strange given the segregation in place at the time, but the invisibility of recorded and broadcast music may have enabled more mixing of musical genres than would have been possible in person. Recording technology continued to evolve before and after the Second World War. Electric recording using condenser and ribbon microphones eliminated the need for the audio cone and improved sound quality on recordings. The 78 RPM disc became standard, as did its 4.5 minutes of playback. Audio recording on magnetic tape, developed by the Germans during the war, was brought home by the victorious American side in 1947. A company called Ampex released the first American model in 1948. Finally, the development of the LP by Columbia in the late 40s allowed folk music collectors increased portability with more songs on one disc. In 1952, magnetic tape masters were used by the small record company Folkways to reissue the sounds of 1925 to 1932 with great fidelity on the 6 LP set, The Anthology of American Folk Music. The anthology, compiled by one Harry Smith, was like a sonic time machine carrying the listener to the pre-war past. Its release inspired people like Ralph Rinsler to track down living artists like Doc Boggs and Clarence Ashley from the anthology and bring them to the famous Newport Folk Festival. While sales of the anthology were not massive, it was a 6 LP set that retailed for almost $35 at a time when a regular LP was $3 to $4. Sales to libraries and schools appear to have expanded the reach of the release. Bob Dylan and Joan Baez, prominent artists from the New York folk scene in the late 50s and early 60s, report that while people knew of the compilation, few in the scene had access to the anthology. Most had heard songs from that era on borrowed records or as part of a secondary oral process when the songs were performed by other singers. This seems plausible given the regular hootenannies at Greenwich Village's George Washington Park. These were attended by young people carrying guitars, banjos, and other stringed instruments. Songs heard from other singers, from early 78 RPM records, or from the recent releases by groups like The Weavers, featuring Pete Seeger, or the Kingston Trio, were shared as part of what the singers believed was a living tradition. By the mid-60s, strains had begun to develop onto the folk community as some artists moved out of the Greenwich folk clubs and onto the national stage, adapting their performances and style for broader appeal. Many observers believe the signal for the end of the folk boom was Bob Dylan's electric performance at the 1965 Newport Folk Festival. This controversial moment pitted purists who saw folk as an expression of a community against those who felt the artistic expression of the individual artist was more important. The folk boom itself was an inspiration for many to begin their own exploration and collections of folk music. Among these was British Columbia's own Phil Thomas, whose Songs of the Pacific Northwest showcases songs from ranchers, loggers, fishermen, and political activists over the 250-year history of the colony and province. The folk boom was also a catalyst for a lower-level but enduring interest in folk in the English-speaking world that continues today. Indeed, the author has played and still regularly attends local folk clubs populated mostly by survivors of the 60s revival and also accesses old recordings on vinyl for inspiration and enjoyment. In the years since the revival, the development of wider musical categories like American roots music began to encompass styles that were not part of the original conception of American folk music, such as spirituals, blues, Hawaiian, bluegrass, old time, jug bands, Cajun, Native American, among others. Roots music is so named because these forms of music are now considered the roots of many American forms like rock, R&B, and jazz. The bigger tent of roots music allows modern roots artists to absorb inspiration and influences from anywhere and to mix electric and acoustic sounds without fear of betraying a community. The Anthology of American Folk Music was re-released on compact disc in 1997 by the Smithsonian to much acclaim. Now, access to the sounds of the 20s and 30s is again accessible for those without access to a vinyl copy. Being able to listen to the recordings and songs that inspired the artists of the folk revival, as well as the early forms of jazz and blues, continue to inform and inspire roots and Americana musicians all over the world. The tangibility, portability, and repeatability of these and other early recordings of American musicians played and continues to play a significant role in the development of these unique American sounds and forms of expression.
Drill, drill, for we work all day without sugar in our day when we work on the CP railway. Still it's drill, Yatarius, drill. The very next day we heard a cry and saw poor Jim coming from the sky. He lit on top of some rock dump, said he, well that's a damn fine bump. And it's drill, Yatarius, drill. Drill, Yatarius, drill. For we work all day without sugar in our tay when we work on the CP Railway. Still it's drill, your Toria's drill. When payday next did come around, Big Jim, $1 short was found. What for, said he, came this reply: you're docked for the time you spent up in the sky. And it's drill, Yataria's drill. Drill, Yataria's drill. For we work all day without sugar in our tay when we work on the CP Railway. Still it's drill, Yataria's drill. Dig a hole. He cursed and damned our Irish souls. He cursed the ship that brought us through to work on his CP Railway crew. And it's drill, Yataria's drill. Drill, Yataria's drill. For we work all day without sugar in our tay when we work on the CP Railway. Still it's drill, Yataria's drill. Drill, Yataria's drill. Drill, Yataria's drill.